Musingwini was born in 1968 in Morewa, Zimbabwe. He holds a BSc Honours degree in Mining Engineering from the University of Zimbabwe and obtained MSc and PhD degrees in Mining Engineering from the University of the Witwatersrand. He's a fellow of the South African Institute of Mining Metallurgy and is a registered professional engineer with Excel. He's a member of the International Society of Mining Professors and is a rated researcher with the National Research Foundation, NRF. He has over 20 years of mining engineering experience in mine production management and planning, consulting, and academia. Cuthbert commenced his career as a graduate trainee with Londra Zimbabwe's Independence Gold Mining in 1991 and quickly rose through the production ranks as miner, shift boss, and mine captain. In 1996, he joined the German-funded GTZ UZ Riverbed Mining Project as a research fellow, while concurrently studying for a part-time MSc degree in Mining Engineering at WITS. In 2000, he was appointed as a lecturer at UZ and became head of department in 2003. In 2004, he emigrated to South Africa to join WITS as a lecturer, completing his PhD in 2009 and was promoted to senior lecturer in 2010. Associate professor in 2012, and full professor in 2014. In 2015, Cuthbert was appointed as the head of school of mining engineering at WITS, a position he holds to date. Cuthbert lectures at both undergraduate and postgraduate levels in optimization in mine planning and mine financial evaluation. He has supervised several MSc and PhD research students and occasionally examines PhD theses in mine planning and evaluation for the University of Queensland and Curtin University in Australia. Cuthbert has been a resource person on the Netherlands Initiative for Capacity Development in Higher Education for capacity building projects at the University of Zambia's School of Mines and the Instituto Superior Politecnico di Tete in Mozambique. He was previously an associate consultant for two South African consulting companies specializing in mining business optimization and valuation, namely MineQuest and Venma. He was elected in council in 2011 and became an office bearer in 2013. He has served on the mining TPC since 2008, the SIMM's International Platinum Conference Organizing Committee since 2010, and previously on the SIMM Student Colloquium Organizing Committee between 2010 and 2012. He has served on EXA's Professional Advisory Committee, Mining Engineering since 2010, and EXA's Engineering Program Accreditation Committee since 2013. Cuthbert is a managing editor of the International Journal of Mining, Reclamation and Environment, published by the Taylor and Francis Group in the UK, and has been on the editorial board of the Journal of the SIMM since 2008. He has served on the International Organizing Committee for the Mine Planning and Equipment Selection Conferences since 2012, and was the chairperson of MPES 2015, which South Africa was privileged to host for the first time in the 25-year history of the conference. There are some highlights worth sharing in Cuthbert's life, spanning from student days to present day. In 1985, he completed O-levels as the top student at Morewa High School, Zimbabwe. In 1991, Cuthbert was the first student to graduate with first-class honours in mining engineering at the University of Zimbabwe since the establishment of the degree programme in 1985. He received the Arthur Bensusan Prize for being the top student in his class and was a recipient of the Londra Zimbabwe Independence Gold Mining Scholarship. In 2010, he was awarded WITS University's Faculty of Engineering and Built Environment Most Improved Researcher Award. In 2014, Cuthbert became the first black honorary treasurer for the SIMM, the first black full professor of mining engineering in South Africa, and the first black NRF-rated researcher in mining engineering in South Africa. In 2015, Cuthbert became the first black head of the School of Mining Engineering at the WITS University in South Africa. He's married to Grace, an alumna of WITS, and they're blessed with two wonderful children. Their son, Shingirai, graduated with a BA law degree from WITS this year in 2016 and is currently completing the remaining modules for an LLB degree. Their daughter, Gamuchirai, is a first-year BBA student at Mill Park Business School. Cuthbert owes his success to others who have opened doors for him, and he's passionate about developing others. In his spare time, Cuthbert enjoys playing mind games, but his to-do list includes golf because he believes that work is for those who cannot play golf. Most importantly, he's a Christ follower and has served Aldersgate Methodist Church in Glen Hazel as a vestry steward and pew Bible reader since 2010. Cuthbert is grateful to the Lord for all the blessings in his life. Congratulations to you, Cuthbert.
Good evening, ladies and gentlemen. Thank you, Mzila, for that spiced up introduction, which makes me wish that my parents could have been here, because my mom would have been very proud, while my dad, like all other dads, would have believed every word you said. I would like to share with you all a revelation that's deliberately missing in Mzila's introduction, as him being the MC, or the most celebrated person this evening, instructed me that I should explain that revelation myself. The word Musingiwini in the Shona dictionary means a small vertical shaft in the ground. The name Musingiwini derives from that root word and means the owner of a mine. You can check that with the Shona dictionary. So, ladies and gentlemen, I'm not in the mining business by mistake. It is, in fact, a genetic calling. When I was choosing the topic of my address this evening, I wanted to share my thoughts with you on a subject matter that is so close to my heart, but I was also cognizant of the fact that the topic should appeal to a diverse audience that includes students, mining engineers, metallurgists, geologists, mine surveyors, environmentalists, and mechanical and electrical engineers who have been contaminated by mining, and other professionals closely associated with mining. I therefore selected the topic, Optimization in Underground Mine Planning, Developments and Opportunities. This evening, I'm going to talk about history, war, creatures, and mining, and their relationships with operations research. To take you through the presentation, I will discuss a brief history on optimization and operations research, techniques in underground mine planning optimization, or UG mine optimization. I'll be referring to that constantly as UG for underground. And to do that, the techniques I will look at is linear programming and its variants, which is integer programming, binary integer programming, and mixed integer programming. And I will also refer to dynamic programming. And these two that I have got in black are specifically in black because they are what we call exact algorithms. They are solved using exact algorithms, whilst the remaining in red are solved by what we call heuristic or approximate algorithms. And to do that, I will discuss genetic algorithms, particle swarm optimization, and colony optimization, simulated and simulated annealing. I'll then discuss issues around circular logic of underground mine optimization and uncertainty associated with that. I will then take you through underground mine optimization developments, which speaks to my topic, and specifically looking at four broad areas, and you'll see later on in the presentation why we have those four broad areas. Development infrastructure layout, stop envelope sizing, production scheduling at both short and long term, equipment selection and deployment. I will then discuss underground mine optimization opportunities and then conclude my presentation. What we see here is a picture of Mahatma Gandhi, who lived between 1869 and 1948. What do we know about this man? One thing that comes to the fore is that he is widely known for the non-violent 1907 to 1914 passive resistance campaign in South Africa. What you may not know is that he is also attributed to having said that, I quote, "Earth provides enough to satisfy every man's needs, but not every man's greed," close quote. These words were true back then, are true now, and will remain true into the foreseeable future, as there will never be sufficient resources to satisfy human greed. I always tease my optimization students that all human beings have a sixth sense. We all learn 5 senses in school, but there's a sixth sense called greed. And that none of us, myself included, are spared from this sixth sense. We are all greedy. Why? I'll give you an example. We always want more and more. If you earn 10 million, for example, and it is doubled to 20 million, it won't be long enough before you go and see your boss to say that it is no longer enough. Even when it is upped to 100 million, you still want more. Not because of need, but because of that sixth sense, greed. The observation that human beings have a sixth sense of greed is a key premise in the study of economics, which recognizes that humans have unlimited wants that must be satisfied from scarce resources. Consequently, mankind must make choices to optimally allocate the scarce resources in order to satisfy human wants, but I must qualify this within the limits of reasonable greed. Otherwise, there is no hope that we can continue to survive on Earth. Managing scarce resources optimally is also core to the discipline of operations research. As I said earlier that I was going to talk about war and operations research, I need to take that statement further. Operations research had its origins in the United Kingdom around the early 1930s, that is the pre-World War II era, when decision-making techniques were used by the British Royal Air Force and Army to find effective ways to kill as many enemy targets as possible. And I'll qualify that. Who are the enemy targets, or what is the enemy targets? It's as many people as possible. And doing that using the least amount of resources, remembering that with operations research, what we want to do, we want to achieve more with less. The problems included operations such as bombing, what we see here in the slide, anti-submarine strikes, the deployment of radar and management of convoy. The application of mathematical, scientific and engineering methods to military operations led to this practice being called operations research. Several manufacturing companies were closed during the war, due to the war, and therefore limiting supply of resources. That's why you want to achieve more with less. And such work involved, for example, determining trade-offs to evaluate what would be more effective, which is what we see here in the slide, throwing one large bomb or many small bomb parcels at an enemy target, but in both cases using the same amount of bomb material while increasing the probability of killing. Of course, such history bears some moral apprehension, but this history. In the post-World War II era, ex-military operations research workers moved into peacetime disciplines, thus triggering the spread of operations research to universities and different industries. This marked the emergence of systematic training of operations research professionals. Since most operations research work involves carrying out a large number of numerical calculations, its proliferation has to a large extent been made possible by the widespread availability of computers and their greatly improved performance and data storage capacities. The mining industry is like a dinosaur, always slow to adapt. Although operations research started in the 1930s, like I said earlier on, optimization in mining can only be traced back to the 1960s with the seminal work or pioneering work of Helmut Lex, a mathematician, and Ingo Grossman, who was coming from an electrical engineering sciences background. Here's a picture of Lex on the left and that of Grossman on the right, who sadly died in 1985. They were both with IBM in Canada when they developed in the 1960s a procedure for finding the optimum design for an open pit mine, widely known as the Lex Grossman or LG algorithm. On realizing that their algorithm could not be implemented on computers due to limited computing power at that time, Lex and Grossman decided to publish their findings in the Canadian Mining and Metallurgical Bulletin of 1965, so owning the intellectual property or IP rights to the algorithm they had developed. They did this with the hope of revisiting implementation of the documented LG algorithm at a later stage when computing power had improved. True to their expectations, it was in 1986 that Jeff Whittle, who had become known to them, successfully developed, together with his team, the first computer-based application of the LG algorithm, which is now widely known in the mining industry as the Whittle software package. If you ask anyone in open pit mining about pit design software they know, they are likely to tell you that it is Whittle. Since the advent of Whittle software, optimization is widely applied in mining, specifically in mine planning. So, what is operations research? I've been talking about operations research. Operations research, or OR, techniques are optimization techniques, and these are scientific decision-making methods which we use to solve complex systems management problems by applying modern science and mathematics in order to select the best or optimal decision from possible alternative solutions. But we do this under conditions requiring the allocation of scarce resources, which I spoke about earlier on, and in some cases, balancing competing objectives. Ultimately, what we want to achieve with operations research is to achieve more with the same, or more with less. For example, if you have two employees who produce 5 ounces of gold per month, with operations research, we could get them to produce 10 ounces of gold per month, but by doing things differently. Let's briefly discuss some of the basic operations research terminology, as it is pervasive in the remainder of my presentation. Modeling is fundamental to operations research. An operations research model, unlike our fashion models in the likes of Naomi Campbell, is a simplified representation of a system or system behavior expressed in scientific and mathematical frameworks. There are 5 main categories of operations research models, which are, as you see on the screen, optimization models, simulation models, network models, multi-criteria decision-making models, and global optimization models. An optimization model, I will now discuss this in a bit more detail, or flesh them out a bit. An optimization model is a mathematical formulation that is solved to produce a single optimal solution through a process of either maximization of desirable outputs or minimization of undesirable outputs. A simulation model is a model for comparing alternatives without necessarily guaranteeing an optimal solution, but is suitable for answering what-if type of questions or analyzing risk in cases where decisions must deal with uncertainty. A network model is a model that is solved using a graphic visualization, also often producing a single optimal solution. A multi-criteria decision-making model, or MCDM model, is a model that is employed when decisions require several criteria to be considered simultaneously, and generally the decision-making criteria are either competing, conflicting, or contradictory. For those who were able to attend my inaugural lecture as a full professor at WITS, I actually spoke to this subject matter. Trade-offs have to be met among the criteria in order to derive an optimal solution. A global optimization model, which is the last one, is a model that is used to find a solution to an intractable optimization problem. What do I mean by that? Very, very difficult to solve without necessarily guaranteeing an optimal solution. For example, the traveling salesman problem, or TSP, in which a traveling salesman must visit several customers in different cities, each customer once, must use the shortest overall route. And the big question is always, from which city must he start, and in which city must he end in? Many permutations do exist. In order to solve these models that I spoke about, we need a methodology or a way to do that. And we do that using what we call algorithm. An algorithm is an iterative step-by-step procedure that is used to test model validity and produce an optimal solution. We have two types of algorithms: exact algorithms and heuristic algorithms. Exact algorithms have mathematical proofs and generate optimal solutions, while heuristic algorithms, or approximate algorithms, are inspired by natural behavior to generate near optimal solutions. That's why at the beginning I said I'll talk about war, I'll talk about creatures, because of natural, the issue around natural behavior. Why should we bother ourselves with optimization in underground mine planning? That's the key question. It is mainly due to the fact that the seminal work of the 1960s, which I spoke about, by Lex and Grossman, was on open pit optimization. And this has grown to a level where some mining professionals are now claiming that open pit optimization has probably reached saturation levels. Underground optimization is just a few decades old due to its computational complexity, which I'll come back to later on. Operations research methods have inherent limitations since models are a simplification of reality. Therefore, problems should not be forced to fit a model in order to solve the model. Most optimization problems in underground mine planning do not perfectly fit exact algorithms. You may want to recall here that the exact algorithms, the two that were in black that I spoke about, which were LP and its variants and dynamic programming. And these underground mine planning optimization problems do not fit this all the time and are therefore best solved using heuristic approaches. The remainder of my presentation therefore emphasizes heuristic algorithms, which include genetic algorithm, particle swarm optimization algorithm. If you recall those algorithms I spoke about that were in red, and colony optimization, and simulated annealing, as these have been used to to solve optimization problems in underground mine planning. I would like us to now briefly discuss the six optimization algorithms that are used in optimization in underground mine planning. That is the two exact algorithms and the four heuristic algorithms. I will start with linear programming, which in 1947 was introduced by George Bernard Danzig, who developed a procedure called the simplex algorithm for solving linear programming problems. Students of optimization are always introduced to this algorithm on how you actually solve that. The general formulation of the LP problem is we want to optimize Z, which is a sum of Ci Xi for all I equal to 1 up to n, and we do this subject to some constraints, and the constraints are given by Ax equal to b, where Xi is greater than 0 or equal to 0, since quantities cannot be negative. Z here is the objective function to be maximized or minimized with respect to those variables, Xi. A is the matrix of coefficients of Ci, of Xi, and B is a vector of constraint limits. Depending on the type of the value that Xi is restricted to take, linear programming has variants which are, I spoke about this earlier on, integer programming, if Xi can only take on whole numbers, that is integers, or binary LP, if Xi can only take either a zero or a one, which is like your switch, it's either on or off, and mixed integer programming, where Xi can be integer or decimal. The LP variants have been applied widely for optimization in underground mine planning, as chronicled in the paper by Newman and other authors in 2010. Let's now look at the next exact algorithm, which is dynamic programming. Dynamic programming was developed in 1957 by Richard Bellman, and he developed this framework based on a recursion or recursive on a recursive formula. If you look at the formulation below, which is shown in that table with stage 1 to stage 4, dynamic programming system is optimal when beginning from a stage n, you can take it to the end, regardless of the decisions you have taken to enter n, but such that your optimal result, your final result is actually optimal. So for that stage, what do I mean by that? For this four-stage problem, where we want to maximize output, and we know that S3 is greater than S2, S2 is greater than S1, then the state S3 in stage 4 is the optimal choice when you are moving from stage 3 to stage 4. The general recursive formula, which is a function fn, is an optimization where you're looking at the previous function value, fn minus 1, plus gn, where gn is the value for moving from n, the previous stage, n minus 1, to the new stage n. And the LG algorithm, which I spoke about, which was developed by Lex and Grossman in 1965, actually uses this, or was based on this algorithm. Dynamic programming has been used for optimization in underground mine planning for grade control and scheduling in a sub-level open stopping operation, such as in the work reported by Dodd and Elvan in 1987. Peter Dodd is still very active, based in Australia, and I also interact with him from time to time. Now, let's just look at heuristic algorithms, starting with the genetic algorithm. Now I start to talk about creatures. Remember, I said early on, I'll be talking about creatures. What have creatures got to do with mining? A lot, we are going to discover that. So now I start talking about creatures such as rabbits, bees and birds and their associated natural behavior. In 1975, John Holland presented a genetic algorithm for solving optimization problems by mimicking the biological process of evolution through natural selection. Those of us who've done psychology and sociology will know the story around Charles Darwin talking about survival of the fittest. Consider a normal population of rabbits where some are faster and smarter than others. The faster and smarter rabbits are less likely to fall prey to predators. But some of the slower and dumb survive out of sheer luck. The large number of the faster and smarter rabbits that survive continues to do what rabbits do best. Make more rabbits among themselves. But also, they don't just do it among the smarter and faster, but they also do it with the slower and less smart that have survived out of sheer luck. But ultimately, if you follow through the logic, it is expected that the resulting baby rabbits will, on average, be faster and smarter. If this natural behavior is then formulated into a mathematical framework for optimization, it has generally three steps, which we see in this slide. And these steps, you generate an initial population of size n, and then from that population, you then do three things, which is to generate offspring. Three things to do that, to generate offspring through selection, you do crossover, you do mutation, so that ultimately we can end up with the faster and smarter rabbits. Then, once we have done that, we repeat step two until mathematically we have function values of the points f of xi, where I is about 1 up to n, that are so close to each other. And what this tells us is we are converging at the optimal value. And once you have this and you do the mathematical calculation of standard deviation, you'll see that these function values are so close, the standard deviation is very small, implying that we are reaching convergence. Cumrow, who is in Canada, I also have dealings with him at the moment, in 2004 used genetic algorithm for production blending from different mining locations to a central processing facility to maximize net present value, or NPV, over time. Let's look at the other creatures. And this time, we discuss particle swarm optimization. And you will see, as I step through a number of these, unfortunately, we don't seem to see mining engineers. I don't know what's wrong with us as mining engineers. Professionals from other disciplines. Kennedy, who is a social psychologist, and Eberhardt, an electrical engineer, they developed the particle swarm optimization algorithm in 1995 to solve optimization problems in engineering. And they did this by mimicking social behavior of animals, fish, and flying creatures such as bees and birds. So suppose we have a flock of hungry birds, which you see in the picture there. They are all looking for food, isn't it? And they start to randomly fly, looking for food in a finite area. Initially, none of the birds has any knowledge on the exact location of the food source or the food. But any bird must have the best strategy for finding the food quickly. Remember, these birds are hungry. They must feed. By frequently changing flying direction suddenly, that is, in mathematical terms, velocity change, scattering, and then regrouping, you will see birds doing this in the air. The birds engage, or are actually engaging, in social exchange of information. Individual birds are able to profit from the discoveries and previous experiences of other birds during the search for food. And since the birds, which we now call, which we can model as particles, that's why we have this particle swarm optimization algorithm. So since the birds or the particles change their position or state with time, the particles in a population, that population is a swarm, we consider it as a swarm. So you can see how these are coming together, particle swarm optimization. So then these then move around in a three-dimensional space in search of promising regions. In our case with the birds, searching for where we are likely to find the next food source. And they do this, and in mathematical terms, what are we trying to do? We are looking for lower functional values, which are analogous with shorter traveling distances within that finite space than the previously visited regions. The particle adjusts its flying position, which in mathematical terms is a vector addition according to its own experience and position as an individual, which is the personal best position, and that of its neighbors, the other birds that are flying together with that bird, and we call that the global best position. And they, like I said, they engage in information sharing. So through social sharing of information while flying, once a bird identifies food, you can see that in that picture there, it has now found food. Others quickly follow. You can see what has happened. Using the shortest or optimal distance to join the feeding frenzy, you can see the birds are now feasting. As I said earlier on, that when the bird changes its direction, which is a vector addition, the shortest or optimal distance is obtained through a vector addition of the personal best position, which is the bird's own, and the global best position. Now, suppose that at a time t1, on that figure we have at the top there, a particle is at a position O, with its personal best position as A and global best position as C, which it is being informed by the rest of the population or the rest of the swarm. If the current velocity of the particle is B, it will then have a resultant direction defined by that vector OD, which is an addition of the personal best and the global best position. We have two authors, Khan and Niemann-Dehlers, in 2014, who summarized this particle swarm optimization formulation in those two equations. They may look intimidating, but they are very simple. XIT is the position or vector at time, at position I and time t, which is now. And all you're doing is you're looking at the previous position, xi, at time t minus 1, which is the previous position. And then you do that vector or velocity change, which is your vit at time t. And the second position, the second equation, then just describes the relationship where you are now bringing in factors which are being informed by the rest of the population. And we then do the vector addition using that second equation. The particle swarm optimization algorithm combines, like I said, personal best position, which is your local position, with global best position. So we are combining local search methods and global search methods. If we then translate this to the mining environment, where does it fit in? Personal best is analogous to short-term scheduling because we're just looking at the next production time period. And global best is analogous to the long-term scheduling in mine planning. So the particle swarm optimization algorithm can be used to simultaneously integrate optimization of the short-term and long-term planning in 3D space. And it's one of the challenges that we have in the industry. How do we actually integrate, make sure that our short-term plan is actually speaking and is in sync with our long-term plan? And the two gentlemen that presented those two formulas, Khan and Niemann-Dehlers, And another two authors, Goodfellow and Dimitra Kopoulos, who is based in Canada. Dimitra Roussos, Dimitra Kopoulos is also one of the people that I'm associated with. And we have a strong relationship with his research group in Canada called COSMO. And we actually, out of that COSMO, we have a COSMO scholarship which funds a master's student in the School of Mining Engineering at VITH. And they have used the particle swarm optimization algorithm for optimizing mine scheduling. The next algorithm I'd like to discuss is the anti-column algorithm, which was developed by Marco Dorigo in 1992 to mimic the behavior of ants searching for food. And then he used that behavior to find an optimal path in a graph. And let's just have a quick look at this behavior. Where is my mouse now? It has disappeared. Okay, there it comes. Right. So ants by nature initially wander randomly until they find food. Then they return to their colony while releasing pheromone, a hormone that triggers a social response by members of the same species on the food trail, as you see in purple in this animation. When other ants find the food path by following the pheromone, they tend to stop traveling at random and follow the food trail, while strengthening the attractiveness of the path by releasing more pheromone along the path. You will see that we now have an established path and it's strengthening, the purple color is getting strong. The pheromone evaporates with the passage of time, reducing the attractiveness of that path. A short path, therefore, gets traveled more frequently, thus increasing the pheromone density compared to longer paths. Pheromone evaporation has the advantage of avoiding the convergence to a locally optimal solution. If there were no evaporation at all of the pheromone, all the paths chosen by the first ants will tend to be excessively attractive than subsequent paths. In that case, the exploration of the solution space would be constrained in mathematical terms. When an ant finds a short path from the colony to a food source, other ants are more likely to follow that path, thus reinforcing positive feedback and eventually leading to all the ants following that path, which we can see is now strengthened in this slide here. The idea of the ant-colony algorithm is to mimic this behavior with simulated ants walking around the graph representing the problem to be solved. The ant-colony optimization algorithm has been used for optimization in mine production scheduling, such as in the work by Gilani and Sutherland in 2016. The next physical or natural behavior, which speaks to my metallurgy friends in the room, physical metallurgists, is based on the Metropolis algorithm, which was based on simulated annealing. Annealing is a heat treatment process that involves heating a metal to above its recrystallization temperature, followed by gradual cooling in still air or quenching in water to produce a workable metal that is more ductile and less hard, because its lattice structure would have been altered in the process. Rapid cooling usually results in local minima being formed. That is not the strongest of the lattice structure we can get. While slow cooling, which takes more time, is likely to result in global minima being formed. Hence the idea of global optimization. The Metropolis algorithm starts by setting the surrounding temperature at T, you can see in that table there, then randomly selecting a state of the system of atoms or particles, SI, which has a corresponding energy state, EI. The system is agitated, and a new state, SI, with energy EJ, SJ, with energy EJ is established. If the change in energy delta E, which is the new state, EJ, compared to the earlier state EI is negative. That is, J is a lower energy state than I. It means there's a reduction in energy. So SJ is accepted. Otherwise, the new high energy state is accepted, but with probability expressed as exponent negative delta E over KB times the temperature. And that is the metropolis algorithm. Kirkpatrick and others then used this simulated annealing algorithm to develop for generic optimization. The analogy or analogy between physical annealing and global optimization is as follows. In physical annealing, we start in a molten state at high temperature. What we're doing in optimization is we are doing a random selection of a starting point, and we run through that until we reach a global optimum configuration. Dimitra Koplos, a resource in Canada, worked with one of his postgrad students, Lady, in 2014, and they used simulated annealing for mine production scheduling and generated schedules where NPVs were about 25% greater than those generated from conventional production scheduling. There is power in using these algorithms. Now that I have discussed the basics of optimization techniques, I would like to now turn to optimization in underground mine planning. As I mentioned earlier on in the presentation, optimization in open pit planning is well developed, widely applied, and probably to a point of saturation, as some professionals are actually indicating. The challenge now with underground mining optimization is that each underground mine is unique in its design and operation to suit deposit-specific characteristics, thus making generic optimization difficult. In addition, most optimization algorithms in underground mine planning, and it has been proved over and over again, fail to guarantee true optimality in 3D space. Hence, optimization in underground mine planning is very fertile ground for more work to be done going into the future. At the moment, it remains largely academic, except for the work that was done by Chris Alford in Australia, who developed the floating stop algorithm, which is now embedded in software which most of us in the room are familiar with, Datamine. There's also Snowden's stop sizer and the angle of platinum optimization tool. And these are practical examples where you can actually use software for scheduling. Another challenge worth noting is that for an open pit mine, the direction of mining is essentially down and out to the pit limits, as you can see. However, optimization in underground mine planning is computationally more difficult, because there are several permutations to the direction of mining. You can, in underground mining, you can actually mine this one, this stop below, before that one, and so on. So there is no clearly defined constraints as we have in open pit mining. You can mine in advance and then retreat. So, which is unlike the simply, you know, the very simple, straightforward open pit optimization approach. There's also another challenge, which is the circular logic in underground mine optimization, which is compounded by geological, technical, and economic uncertainty. Let me now draw your attention to the circular logic and why we need to rely on heuristic algorithms to solve underground mine planning optimization problems. That's why I was talking about those creatures, those animals, and heuristics, because we need to apply them. The optimization objective is to maximize the net present value of the mine design, but the development and stop layout, this is now the circular logic that I'm talking about. It's like your chicken and egg situation. So you want to maximize the net present value, but for you to do that, you must have had these preceding steps. But for these preceding steps to have happened, you must have made that decision on mining method selection and capacity determination. But for that to have happened, this then informed production costs, and you can do your cutoff grade calculation. We have, I have one staff member in the school who's actually doing a PhD on that cutoff grade optimization. And you can see that the logic is secure. It's a chicken. Where do you, which must start? And this is where we get caught up in. So this secular logic makes optimization in underground mine planning computationally complex. Hence, to date, not much work has been done in the area of optimization in underground mine planning. As I mentioned a few moments ago, the secular logic in underground mine planning is compounded by geological, technical, and economic uncertainty, which introduces several challenges to the optimization problem. The intention of optimization is to generate a mine plan that is sufficiently robust to ensure actual outcomes are close or equal to planned targets. That's why we plan, because we want to have outcomes that are close to what we are planning. However, geological, technical, and economic uncertainties inherent in all mining operations create a dichotomy where mine plans are deterministic because we need to use crisp values, yet actual operations are stochastic because we end up with a range of values. Hence, there is now that paradigm shift towards stochastic mine planning to recognize that the mining process is actually stochastic and not deterministic. For example, Gold Fields in their 2015 annual report acknowledged that failure to achieve delivery against operational plans was their second top risk for their Australian operations because of this dichotomy that I've just talked about. PricewaterhouseCoopers, in their 2015 review of the top challenges facing the mining industry, which they cleverly titled "The Gloves Are Off," proposed that mining companies should develop adaptable mine plans, and adaptable in the sense that you are moving into that stochastic domain in order to absorb the impact of economic uncertainties, specifically commodity price volatility. Let me therefore address how commodity price volatility can be incorporated into optimization in mine planning. And this is based on work that I've actually examined for a university in Australia at the moment. For volatile commodity prices, Sabo and Pauline in 2010 showed that instead of modeling optimization models using a deterministic commodity price P, one should rather use a stochastic commodity price model for commodity price changes across time periods, because commodity prices do change. And we are always checking on daily news to see where is the gold price, where is the platinum price. It's exactly for that, over the short time periods. And because of that, you can develop a stochastic differential equation, or an SDE, which you can see up there, where R is the risk-free rate of return, delta is the mean convenience yield on holding one unit of that commodity, and sigma is the volatility of P, price P, and DZ is the Y9 increment of the geometric Brown motion of P. HQ and others in 2014 then extended this SDE to generate that long partial differential equation, where V is the value of the mining project, Q is the total mineral reserve, lambda C is the country risk premium, C is the total capex and opex cost, and G is the applicable tax rate. What you will note is that this PDE, or partial differential equation, cannot be solved analytically. Take any mathematician and ask them to solve it, they will not be able to. Therefore, it has to be solved, or we can solve it using heuristic approaches. In order to to address uncertainty, including price volatility, Whittle et al. In 2007 used the LG algorithm, the Lex Grossman algorithm, and at-risk software, which is now commonly applied to handle risk in mining, to generate probability pits. So as you see on the left, unlike a single pit outline, which we do under deterministic mine planning, you then instead generate probability pits. So each color is associated with the probability of actually achieving that pit. So that red would say, given the range or expectation of where the price will be moving, our pit will definitely have almost close to 100% in that red zone. So in this way, it is possible that when price movements then happen, they get higher, your pit could actually extend outwards from the red to the yellow to the green to the blue. And if you had put in infrastructure on any of those areas because you had done deterministic mine planning or optimization, you would have faltered because now you are forced to move the infrastructure to make way for the pit expansion. So a similar approach can be extended to optimization of stop envelopes in underground mine planning, and I will discuss this point again when considering opportunities in optimization in underground mine planning. Where do we break? Which must come first? This is the dilemma we've always faced. Which actually came first in history? Was it the egg or the chicken? And it is the same argument that we have with underground optimization. Where should we actually start? And in order to go around this or to address this circular logic requires us to fragment the underground optimization problem into essentially four broad sub-problems that we can solve or that are tractable. These are development infrastructure layout, stop envelope sizing, production scheduling at both short and long term, and equipment selection and deployment. I will now turn to each of these four areas, starting with optimization of development layout. Unlike open pit mining, underground mining is very unforgiving. Once development infrastructure has been laid out, you are locked into that layout. And if you try to make any future changes, it comes at a capital cost. So, optimization of development layout is very, very, very critical for future operations in underground mining. And this is because development is a cost and needs, therefore, to be spaced out so that you can minimize that cost. However, the moment you do that, by spacing out the development, you have many desirable and undesirable impacts that happen at the same time concomitantly. And some of them are actually conflicting. And this then leads us into the multi-criteria decision-making space. That's why I spoke about MCDM as one of the categories of algorithms or optimization techniques that we have to use in underground mine planning. Several case studies have been reported on application of MCDM techniques. And for my PhD, I actually used that for the optimal layout of development, well received by the platinum mining industry. And it was used in then a number of platinum to actually motivate for the short crosscut mining method. If we then turn to stops, remember the four areas that I spoke about. To generate an optimal stop envelope, we need to look at several blocks, each of economic value, BIJ, and that economic value is a result of what we get out of mining that block and the costs associated with mining that block. But we must do that while satisfying physical mining and geotechnical constraints so that we can produce a layout with the maximum net present value or maximum value. Many possible combinations from adjacent or contiguous mining blocks arise because we consider, as we are doing optimization, whilst observing the geotechnical constraints, we can analyze several stop sizes and pillars so that we can obtain the maximum value stops. And this introduces computational complexity. For example, if you look at the two graphs there, illustrations, the one on the left, if you have a block B, which you want to include in a 3x3 stop size, where you are mining three by three blocks as one stop, you will see that we have 9 possible stop combinations. If you look at variable stop size and you go to just a 4x4, it jumps, the combinations jump to 16. And you, this is an exponential increase. And if you try to solve this using exact algorithms, you run into problems. Hence, we need to rely on heuristic algorithms. So what we see here is there's computational complexity of stop optimization, which necessitates solution by heuristic approaches. Few algorithms have been developed for stop optimization, but like I said earlier on, in 3D space, none of them can actually guarantee true optimality. We have seen the floating stop done by Alford in Australia, now embedded in DataMine, and others have been busy and are still busy trying to use what we call the maximum value neighborhood heuristic algorithm to actually try and solve this stop optimization problem. With production scheduling, it involves, what are we trying to do? We want to determine a mining sequence for those economic stops and development that is required to bring those stops into production. And that mining sequence must give us the maximum value, but subject to operational constraints, because you have milling capacity limitations, mining capacity limitations, grade and geometallurgical constraints, and stop precedence rules as those that are adopted in the APMOT, which I spoke about, the Anglo-Platinum optimization tool. So to solve that, others have also used linear programming variants, such as integer programming, to try and solve short and long-term scheduling. And Alan Guest, who is known to quite a number of us in South Africa, other authors applied large-scale linear programming solution, which is a variant of LP, for scheduling of underground block caving operations in South Africa. The last area, which is equipment selection and deployment, is centered around the argument that geotechnical constraints dictate the size of mining excavations, hence the dimensions of equipment that can fit into those excavations. But we also do that while complying with legal requirements for safety. Once maximum equipment dimensions are known, we scout around for the equipment suppliers, and we can identify the equipment sizes, and then equipment optimization becomes a two-stage problem. Firstly, you want to optimize your fleet size, and secondly, your equipment deployment once you know the equipment that you're going to use. For the first stage, multi-criteria decision-making techniques have been used generally for selection of underground mining equipment fleets. And for the second stage, we rely on simulation using such software as GPSS and Arena software. I've previously supervised a master's student who then used Arena software for equipment simulation. In some cases, models based on LP variants have also been used for optimal equipment deployment, but backed up by simulation analysis. In order to optimize equipment deployment, other techniques such as the theory of constraints, or TOC, have been used. And Rod Pickering, who is the past president of the SAIMM, did some work with Andrews, and they reported a 32% improvement in machine cycle time for an underground mechanized mining operation. So, these are the developments that have happened. This is where we are. This is how far we have walked down that road. But what opportunities still exist? These are informed by what is required to move us forward in terms of optimization in underground mine planning. Firstly, It is always important to understand the optimization processes in mine planning in order to meaningfully interpret and communicate the results that we get for informed decision making. In this context, the following opportunities exist in underground mine planning. Firstly, industry can take advantage of postgraduate specializations in this area. At VIS, in my school, we introduced an MSc specialization in mine planning and optimization in 2014. At the moment, we attract about 10 to 15 master's students every year, and the first batch will actually be graduating this year, those that would have done the coursework and then gone on to complete their research projects. In addition to that, I have a small research group, the MPOV, Mine Planning and Optimization and Evaluation Research Group in the school. There's currently five of us who are actually working in this area, and most of them are actually working at PhD level to try and look at ways of resolving these challenges we have in underground mine planning optimization. We also need to plan mining processes as a stochastic process. Hence, we're starting to see, if you go into literature, there's now this gradual paradigm shift from deterministic to stochastic optimization. This stuff I spoke about earlier on probability pit design by Whitlow and others, we can also extend that to probability pit design and improve the confidence in the planning of underground mining operations. But one of the challenges we face is, remember the circular logic, the chicken egg situation, you have to fragment the problem into areas. Is going forward, once we have had a lot of activity, there's opportunity to actually go for an integrated approach, and we can guarantee true optimality in 3D space. But once that happens, because we are in a stochastic space, you produce a range of values, we need to be very clever and smart in how we do it, and develop ways of simple and effective communication so that this work actually takes more ground in our industry. And one of the ways would be to look at, say a production output where you have a range of values, and you then compare that and say, I would like to use, you know, a production output C, which I'm planning, and then compare, do a variance analysis with the historical data where that exists, and if it doesn't exist, look for a similar operation, and then ensure that your variances are at a minimum. And that's the number which you can then report, but you have actually done all this stochastic analysis to recognize the mining system as a stochastic process, but you are now communicating a crisp number to the decision makers. So in conclusion, optimization, open pit optimization is well developed because it started in the 1960s, routinely applied, because we've seen that the mine planning problem or optimization problem in open pit mining is very simple. Direction of mining is out and down to the pit limit. So the next challenge that I brought up was optimization in underground mine planning is computationally more complex because of the numerous computations and permutations we have. And hence we need to rely on heuristic algorithms, which are informed by nature, those creatures that I was talking about. The underground mine planning optimization problem can be divided into four isolated or fragmented areas, which I spoke about: development infrastructure layouts, stop envelope sizing, production scheduling, equipment selection, and deployment. And what I see, and these are my thoughts, is the future of optimization in underground mine optimization will be characterized by integrating those four areas in 3D stochastic optimization, but we must do it in a simple, smart, and effective way so that we can communicate for meaningful decision making. I hope I have convinced you to seriously consider optimization so that you can achieve more with less, but please don't do it to the extent of my CEO friend, who was so efficient that he was doing more with less, and the board had no option but to call him in and say, Mr. CEO, we are so happy that you are able to achieve more with less. Now, we would like you to do everything with nothing. Thank you all for coming. And if there's one message that I would like you to take with, please remember that heuristic optimization in mining is inspired by nature. Think about those creatures, how they behave, and how you can use that to optimize your operations.